Before I begin, I'd like to say a word about the International Criminal Court's issuing arrest warrants for Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu and former Defense Minister Gallant. The ICC's decision is outrageous, unlawful, and dangerous. Israel has a right to defend itself, and the ICC's rogue actions only enable the terrorists who seek to wipe Israel off the map. These actions threaten Israel, but left unchecked, they could pose a threat to the United States in the future. The Senate needs to stand strongly with our ally at this time. I am again calling on Leader Schumer to bring a bill to the floor sanctioning the ICC, which the House has already passed with bipartisan support. Last night, the Senate sent a strong bipartisan message of support for Israel by rejecting resolutions that would have denied Israel the lethal aid that they need. Now the Democrat leader needs to bring up the ICC sanctions bill. If he chooses not to act, the new Senate Republican majority next year will. We will stand with Israel and make this bill and other supportive legislation a top priority in the next Congress. In 6 weeks, Republicans will retake the majority here. And when we do, we will make it clear that the United States stands squarely in Israel's corner. Mr. President, a Democrat congresswoman said the quiet part out loud the other day when she admitted that while she would have supported the abolishment of the filibuster if Democrats had won full control of Washington, she did not support abolishing the filibuster now that Republicans have gained control. This is her quote, "I am championing getting rid of the filibuster now when the Senate has the trifecta." Actually, let me repeat that. She asked it as a question. Am I championing getting rid of the filibuster now when the Senate has the trifecta? She answered, and I quote again, "No, but had we had the trifecta, I would have been, because we have to show that government can deliver," end quote. Let me repeat that, Mr. President. Had we had the trifecta, I would have been supportive of abolishing getting rid of the filibuster. In other words, one rule for Democrats and one rule for everybody else. Democrats should be able to do whatever they want. Republicans, not so much. Mr. President, I happen to agree with the congressman about preserving the filibuster. This essential tool encourages compromise and helps ensure that all Americans, not just those whose party is in the majority, have a voice in legislation. The difference between me and the congresswoman is that I believe that the rules should apply all the time. I don't think there should be special rules for Republicans or, as the congresswoman believes, for Democrats. Mr. President, the congresswoman is perhaps more frank than some Democrats in admitting out loud that she thinks the rules shouldn't apply to Democrats. But her attitude, I have to say, is hardly new. If there's one thing that we've learned over the past few years, it's that Democrats firmly believe that the only legitimate government is a Democrat government. Take Democrats' campaign to undermine the legitimacy of the Supreme Court. Let the court issue any decision that Democrats don't like, and these days you can be confident you will hear some Democrat decrying not just the court's decision, but the court's legitimacy. Never mind the fact that this court, like others before it, is composed of 9 justices duly nominated and confirmed in accordance with the Constitution. Or that so-called liberal justices and so-called conservative justices vote together a substantial percentage of the time. This court sometimes issues decisions that Democrats don't like, and therefore, in their view, the court is somehow illegitimate. Mr. President, I find it ironic that a party that has spent a fair amount of time this election cycle talking about the importance of preserving our democracy seems intent on embracing the thoroughly undemocratic notion that only one party should be making decisions in this country. Well, I hate to tell Democrats, but that's not how it really works. And the idea that one party should have a lock on power and the courts is usually associated with forms of government that go by less pleasant names than democracy. I'm also always struck by the elitism that goes with Democrats' attitude. It's no secret that a lot of people on the left despise individuals who voted for President Trump. Words like racist, sexist, and misogynistic get thrown around to describe voters who are simply tired of Democrats' failed economic policies, or who were worried about the crisis at our border, or who disagreed with many of the Democrats' radical social policies. And Democrats' apparent belief that it's the Democrat Party and the Democrat Party only that should be calling the shots in Washington betrays some of that same disdain for voters. Well, Mr. President, the filibuster is safe for now. And while I don't have high hopes for Democrats changing their tune on the Supreme Court, perhaps being in the minority in this next Congress will at least remind Democrats of the importance of protecting minority rights no matter what party is in power, and ensure that the next time Democrats are in charge, they're not quite so eager to tear down this important safeguard. We can only hope. Mr. President, I yield the floor, and I suggest the absence of quorum.